Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to call to order our first hearing of the evening. This is a 7:30 application of Douglas Baker. The application is dated October 2nd, 2015. Mr. Baker resides at 6 Warner Road in Milton. The property is in a Residence C district. Mr. Baker is seeking a variance in order to build a 4-foot by 15-foot by one-story addition to the right side of his existing two-family residence. And the addition is proposed to be set back 10 feet from the right side property line rather than the 20 feet which are required by Section 6C3 of the bylaw. My name is John Leonard. I'm chairman of the Board of Appeals. With me this evening to my immediate right is Board Member Jeffrey Mullen, and to my immediate left is Board Member Ted Daber. The rules of the board are such that we'll first hear from the applicant, and I understand the applicant has counsel present this evening. I will hear from any persons who have questions of the applicant or the applicant's attorney. We'll then hear from any people who wish to speak in support of the application or wish to speak in opposition to the present application. The proceedings are being tape recorded this evening, which is going to be the official record of the hearing and not the television transmission. So that would ask, this is a fairly large room, the acoustics are poor in this room. So that would ask that anyone who's going to speak do two things. Number one, tell us your name and address before you speak. And secondly, speak up nice and clear and loud so we'll have an accurate record if we have to revert to the record for the purposes of writing a decision. I'll summarize the advertisement for the hearing. We'll have as evidence for this hearing, at least from the outset of the hearing, the application, which is dated October 2nd, 2015. It's signed by Mr. Baker. We have a denial letter from Joseph Prondek, a building inspector. It's dated September 25, 2015. Mr. Baker has filed a plot plan of the subject property by Michael Paul Antonino. It's we have, I think, a couple of plot plans here. This one is dated November 10, 2013, but I thought I saw somewhere in the papers a more recent plot plan. I think this may be it. It does. It shows the 10-foot deviation. It shows the property, the garage, and the relationship of the various amenities on the house to Warner Road and Webster Road. The applicant has also provided us with some plans by registered architect Joseph Genduso. They're dated August 27, 2015. And they show the project from the rear, from the first floor plan, a right side elevation, and a front elevation. So we thank the applicant for submitting all of those materials. We did receive some correspondence from neighbors. We have a full schedule tonight. I'm not going to take the time of reading all of these particular letters, but I will. For the sake of the audience members who have not been able to come to the Board of Appeals office in the afternoon to read the documents, I'll try to summarize them as fairly as I can. The first document is an email from Michael Vahey, V-H-A-Y.
Vahey.
Thanks, Mr. Mullen. Dated October 18th, 2015, and he writes to the board that he understands the applicant has reapplied for a variance. He appreciates the variance being scaled back in size from the one that was previously filed in 2014, which I think essentially was seeking a larger variance on the right side. He submits his earlier letter. Mr. Vay suggests that the reduction in the proposed addition results in nullification and substantial derogation of the bylaw. And while it's better than the applicant's prior application, all of the factors regarding variances have not changed and have not been met. And he encloses the email that he filed in opposition to the earlier variance application, citing the various sections of Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 48, Section 10, and the statutory requirements, and Mr. Vay suggests that None of those statutory requirements are met in this application. Miguel Rodriguez sent an email to us. It's dated October 26, 2015. And Mr. Rodriguez lives at 54 Webster Road, just around the corner from the subject premises. Mr. Rodriguez is unable to attend the board's meeting this evening, but he wants his email made part of the record. He strongly believes that the addition of 10 feet will add undue burden to the abutters at 80 Webster Road. He believes that the addition will partially block their visibility as it nears the sidewalk, and it doesn't conform to the bylaw. He says there's plenty of space for the addition towards the back side of the house, so expanding towards the side is not warranted. He suggests that the setback requirements of the bylaw are necessary to provide light, air, and a modicum of privacy to neighboring properties, and the applicant's proposal doesn't respect those interests. He says that the statutory factors of General Laws, Chapter 48, Section 10, are strict, and that variances should be sparingly exercised. And he suggests this is not a case where the variance should be granted. And we finally received an email from Maureen Brown. It's dated October 27, 2015. Ms. Brown suggests that she's a distant neighbor from the subject property, that Mr. Baker came to her house asking for his for her signature on the application, which must have been some type of a petition assenting to the variance. She signed it, but she says that on the subsequent reflection, she believes that her signature should be ignored, which I think she's withdrawing her signatures on the assent form, and she just wants to be listed as a disinterested party who is not in support of Mr. Baker's application, and she appreciates our taking this up at the public hearing because she's not able to be here. So we thank all of the neighbors for their input, and I understand, is Mr. Brown here, or an attorney representing Mr. Brown present?
Baker.
Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. I said Mr. Baker, but I mean Mr. Brown. Excuse me. I mean Mr. Baker. Sure. Okay, the direct abutters. Okay, great. Is the applicant here, please? Oh, great. Well, come on up here, if you would. You're Mr. Baker.
Right.
And
I'm Joe Gendusso, the architect.
Oh, great. Well, welcome to the Board of Appeals, Mr. Gendusso. I think.
Welcome back.
I think you've been here before.
Yes, I have.
Good. Welcome. Yes. Welcome back. And Mr. Brown, you've been here before as well. We welcome you
I'm
back
Mr.
as well.
Baker. I'm the one going through the variance.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I get Brown and Baker.
And I don't have counsel. I'm here with my architect and neighbors.
Okay, great. Well, is Mr. Gendusso going to make the presentation?
Mr. Baker will explain why he wants the addition. I'm here to answer any questions in terms of...
Mr. Baker, the floor is yours.
I'm just looking to expand out the right rear side of my house, very small, 4 by 15 feet. Doesn't seem like a lot, could even seem, you know, absurdly small, but it actually gives you a much more usable room. My kids are in high school now, and we're looking for more space. And that's what's gonna give you the depth that I'm looking for, as opposed to any other direction. So that's pretty much it. You know, I did go and talk to a lot of neighbors. I have, you know, I showed them the plan that the architect drew, and I asked them, you know, they didn't oppose the bigger one previously, but I just you know, learned from that experience, and I sought more active support of it. So I acquired a great deal of signatures that I have here, and I brought the person who's directly opposed to it, you know, who's going to look at it across the street, not opposed to the project, but...
But the most affected by the project.
Correct, yes. Correct. And when you cited Rodriguez in that opening statement there, if you call it that, 10 feet they had said, so I don't think they had the plan, or they were mischaracterizing what I intended to do. So most of my neighbors understand that, you know, multifamilies, you can keep them owner-occupied, it's a good idea. It's good overall for a neighborhood, and, you know, I'm just trying to make more space for my growing family.
The reasons why we decided to expand in this direction were to create an addition that created a square-shaped room, which is obviously much more usable, much more practical. Also, expansion in this direction does not directly affect the adjacent tenant, and it will not require a major removal of stairs and decks. And if, in fact, we did expand towards the rear, which was a consideration, we end up with a room that's rather long and narrow and not as usable as the shape we have here.
You have the approximate dimensions of that room, if you...
The room right now is approximately 16 by 15 feet, approximately. So it's almost a square. Whereas if we were to expand in the other direction, we're probably looking at 11 by whatever... However farther we go out, could be 11 by 15, 11 by 20. It's just a little odd-shaped room.
It still requires a variance as well.
That would require a variance if we continued along the sidewall and not jogged in an additional 6 feet to get that 20-foot variance. I also noticed, and maybe I'm a little out of my realm here, that the Webster Road becomes a driveway past the applicant's property and down towards number 80 Webster. So as far as traffic goes, I don't see much traffic more than Mr. Baker's and the owners of 80 Webster Road. And if, in fact, stretching it a bit, if that could be considered a driveway, then the 10-foot setback could be in keeping with what might be, in terms of the mechanics of it, a side yard setback. So those are my observations. I'm here to clarify any issues.
Do you have any comments on the statutory factors as to whether they're met here? Or?
I don't, no.
Okay. Let me see if my colleagues have any questions. Mr. David, do you have any questions of Mr. Baker or Mr. Gendusa?
Yeah, you can present that to them.
I'm sorry. Just, do you want to present
the signature?
Yeah,
I'll give you the signatures.
That's great. How many signatures do you have there, Mr. Baker?
So this is a picture of the house. I mean, it goes towards woods.
Right.
All right, so, and the road's private. It's private from here.
Okay, the only thing you got to be careful of, bring the microphone over here, because they won't be able to pick you up. No, the one right here, sir. Yeah, they won't be able to pick you up on the TV line, and they get mad at us when we have private conversations.
So, anyway, I didn't know if it mattered, but they did say at the building department, because I thought it was private, and in fact is. This is public, and then it turns private. My property's here. So what I did was I photocopied this, and I took it around the neighborhood with the plan that the architect drew.
Okay, great.
And so this is my house here, and then it continues. And this is my house here. So they've signed all the way down. All the way down the side of the park, and okay. Some people were home, and I didn't know where the mailing ended, and I just took it around to people were home. And
okay, so you had them sign on the replication of their dwelling.
Yeah, so yeah, okay. It would make sense to you because okay. Mr. Vay, who opposed, he's like way over here. I live here.
Okay.
And my neighbor's here, who's directly would be looking at it, say, so to speak.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Mr. David, do you have any questions of Mr. Baker?
Do you want, I'll try.
Sure. Yeah, why don't we take this? No, you stay right there.
I really don't have too many. So I guess that no sketches were ever done or any plans showing what an addition to the back of the house.
None were presented to the...
Okay. Well, or done, or even done in preparation
for
just...
Well, there was discussion, and there was my yellow trace scribbles that showed a possible expansion in the back. And it netted a space that just wasn't satisfactory in terms of furnishings and all of that.
Okay.
And it also disturbed some of the structure that's there. So it was decided this created the least amount of impact with the maximum effect.
I don't have any more questions right now.
So how long have you owned the house?
20 years. I grew up in Milton, so I've been here most of my life.
And do you have a tenant on the other side?
I do.
And
at 4.
I'm sorry?
At 4 Warner Road.
Right.
I mean, that makes it better for anybody at 4 if I'm not out the back, which isn't necessarily why I didn't go out the back, because, as we said, it's just not the layout that I was looking for. It's better depth going this way rather than Hollish, and still require it. But yes.
And you said that if you did go out the back, you'd still need a variance because you still don't meet the side lot line requirement on the nonconformity, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. You'd have to indent that addition so that it goes into the kitchen.
I'd be here anyway, and it'd
redo.
Be...
Well, unless you satisfied the setback by moving it in and then having the addition adjacent to the family room in the kitchen, we'd have to remove the deck.
Right. And
then you get into a lot of costs. That's what you're saying.
Well, and it also would create a hook-shaped type space because of that indentation.
Right. And if you did do the addition, is the building clapboard now?
Do you have any photos of it?
You gave us a photo, but John put it away. He doesn't like to see all the evidence.
Great. Thank you.
So it would look like the building. It would
be
seamless. You'd paint it the same color, and it would match. The roof would match. And
the intent with that, it would be part of the original.
So it would look as if it was original.
The hip roof.
Oh, there
same
you go.
Windows, that kind
That's
of thing.
That's terrific. Oh, it's shingled.
Yep. So we'd weave the corners like they are there, and so it blends in.
I see. Okay, thank you. But there's nothing particular about this lot, though, that's driving this... This addition. And by that, when I make that question, I'm referring to the statutory standard to which John referred in granting variances about soil conditions, shape, topography of the land. We didn't hear anything about that, and I don't see anything, but I'd like to ask you whether or not there's anything particular about the soil conditions, the shape, and topography of the land that would indicate that the variance should be granted. Anything like that?
The only thing I can say about that in terms of grades is that the grade along the side is much closer to the first floor than the grade along the back. It really slopes off rather sharply on the back, which would cause some additional foundation work
On the hardship issues, it's really about accommodating your family.
Well, that and the associated cost with doing something else.
Doing something else. And the family is, tell us about your family.
His wife and two kids, 9th grade, 10th grade, Milton High School. So they're getting big.
I don't have any more questions. Thank you. I don't have any more questions.
Okay, I don't have any questions of the applicant and Mr. Bindu. So is there anybody present this evening who wishes to speak in support of this application or has questions of...
I have a question.
Yes.
Should we go with the support? Or?
Well, let's do the questions first, and then we'll do who comes to speak in support or in opposition. Why don't you identify yourself, sir?
Good evening. My name is Michael Shinman. I represent the Brown family, who are the direct abutters to the rear.
Okay. Mr. Shinman, why don't you come up here and state your name and address again so it's picked up by the television. And would spell your last name if you would, please, and you can ask your question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Michael Chinman. I'm a lawyer. I live at 433 Elliott Street in Milton. I represent the Brown family, who are the direct abutters to the rear of
Good.
The applicant's
Welcome
property.
Welcome to the Board of Appeals.
Thank you. My question is, what is the intended use of the roughly square room that will be created?
It's where the family's doing most of their living. It's the living room.
It's been characterized by the applicant as a TV room. Is that?
If they watch TV in their living room, that's up to them, I would think.
And what's its current use?
Living space.
Similar living room?
Similar living room, right.
Okay. Thank you. I have no further questions.
Is there anybody else who has any questions of the applicant? Okay, the record indicates there's no such person present, so let's deal with those people, if any, who wish to speak in support of this application. Yes, ma'am. Why don't you come on up here and tell us your name and address, please.
My name is Sarah Kate Filoni. I live at 5 Warner Road. Oh, sure.
And would you spell your last name, please?
F-E-L-O-N-E-Y.
And your address?
5 Warner Road.
5.
Directly across the street.
Good. Welcome to the Board of Appeals. We're
Thank
delighted
you.
To hear from you.
Thank you. And I'm in support for Doug. Yeah, I'll be looking at it every day. He keeps his property meticulous. I have no objection.
Okay.
And that's it.
Anything else you'd like to add?
No, that's
Good.
It.
Anybody have any questions of Ms. Filoni?
No.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Yes. Anybody else who would like to speak in support of this variance application? Okay, the record indicates there's no such person present. Is there anybody present who wishes to speak in opposition to the application for variance? Counselor, come on back.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Could I sit here?
Yes, absolutely.
Again, my name is Michael Chim, and I represent the Brown family who live at 80 Webster Road. I have a few things I'd like to pass up. This is just a diagram showing the plot plan. You can see.
Why don't you explain what it is, and then we'll deal with it.
It shows the lots there. The applicant's has a double lot. Both lots are outlined in color, and then directly behind that double lot is the 80 Webster Road property where the Browns live.
Okay.
This is a photograph from the end of the Browns' driveway, looking up Webster Road towards the applicant's residence. And I may make reference to that more than once. I'm going to call that the blue minivan picture. There's a blue minivan that the applicant parks on the grass next to his house, which is where the addition will be going, on that side of the house. Now,
Mr. Brown, do you want to take a peek at this?
Baker.
Mr. Chairman, why don't you just shoot that down to Mr. Brown?
What's Baker.
Mr. Baker, so that he has it. I've got Brown in my head. I'll never get rid of it.
Now, if you didn't know anything about the lot line and you went to visit this area, I think the thought might naturally be that the line of trees, and there's a retaining wall. This shows the retaining wall better. The blue minivan picture also shows the line of trees and the retaining wall. The natural thought might be that that is the property line. Here's another picture that shows the Brown's house, a thin strip of land, and then the line of trees, retaining wall. That is not the property line. The property line is the driveway of the Brown's house. So it's considerably closer to the Brown's house. Now, the history here is that in 2014, Mr. Baker applied for a variance. The board didn't act on that. Mr. Baker, as I understood it, I wasn't here, but as I understand it, the board urged Mr. Baker to speak to his neighbors and try to come up with a solution, and he withdrew. He was allowed to withdraw the variance without it being denied or approved. And the Browns did oppose that variance at that time. After that variance hearing, Mr. Baker responded by putting this in the driveway, right? That shows you the property line. I'm not saying it's not his property, but he installed that concrete beam with some metal sticking up from it. I believe Mr. Baker would acknowledge that he put that in because the Browns had opposed his request for a variance. So the history here where the board urged Mr. Baker to try to get cooperation and assent from his neighbors, the bottom line is that has not occurred. There may be some logical ways to resolve this, but it hasn't happened. There is no approval or assent from the neighbors. There is, I think it's fair to say, a fairly hostile response from Mr. Baker to the neighbors asserting their rights to oppose the variance. Now, the new variance, it's a different scale, it's true. It's a shorter extension. And it's been characterized as a one-story addition. It's important to realize that from the rear, and I know you have the plans that show the different elevations, it's almost a full two-story addition from the rear because of the slope of the land there. So from the Brown's perspective, they're not looking at a one-story addition. They're looking at a almost full two-story addition. And it'll be an addition that brings the house, the structure, closer to Webster Road. And it's already a non-conforming use because it doesn't meet the setback requirements already the way it exists. This is exacerbating the non-conformity by going even closer to Webster Road. And it's important to emphasize Webster Road is the sole access way to the Brown's property at 80 Webster Road. So this addition will be interfering with the visual lines, the light available to 80 Webster Road. And going back to the blue minivan picture.
Yes, it's up at the end of the table.
I mean, that'll give you a perspective of if you picture the addition coming off of the house, it'll isolate the Browns' property and make it even seem like it's an appendage to the Baker property, which it's clearly not. That's not a driveway, Webster Road, as has been alluded to here. That is clearly a roadway, Webster Road. And as I said, it's the sole access way.
Is it a private way as opposed
that
to
that part of Webster Road is a private way. But that sole access, not only will it cut off lines of vision and light and space, but already when the snow gathers and Webster Road is plowed, there's difficulty about where the snow goes. When this addition, if it's allowed to be put on, that brings the house even closer to Webster Road, that cuts down even more on the space available for snow to be placed, which is a problem exacerbated because Mr. Baker already removed snow from his property onto Webster Road. So this addition is going to cut them off. It'll exacerbate access to the Browns' property at 80 Webster. And I fully join in the email that you read, Mr. Chairman, from Mr. Vey, where he makes the points that there is nothing that affects this lot that does not generally affect that zoning district. This is not the only lot which has sloping land. There's dozens there with that same sloping hill. So there's nothing that has been presented to you that the lot conditions or topography or shape are specific to this lot and do not generally affect the zoning district. This is a preference, not a requirement, that the applicant has to build sideways. And the purpose is not a compelling, pressing one for his family with two children. It's to create a TV room, a square TV viewing room. I don't think that's a compelling need. It's not a hardship, and it's especially not a hardship where they do have a double lot. They could expand to the rear, and even without the indent, they could expand to the rear and maintain the existing nonconformity without exacerbating the existing nonconformity. They could go on the same line that the structure now occupies to the rear if desired. But they don't desire that, and desire is not a reason for a variance. It's a preference, not a need. No hardship has been shown. I would urge the board to deny this variance.
Great. Now, let me see if my colleagues have any questions. Mr. David, do you have any questions of Attorney Chairman?
No. One question, which I think you neglected to do. Could you spell your last name, please?
I'm sorry. C-H-I-N-M-A-N. Chin Man.
That wasn't too difficult. Mr. Mullins, do you have any questions?
Are you putting in a basement?
No, basement's there. This is going out the side.
What's the foundation of the addition? It looks like a poured concrete foundation.
Yeah, yeah. So there'd be only like...
It'd be a shallow foundation, no basement.
But the windows? There's windows there. There's windows in the basement.
To ventilate the crawl space?
Just the ventilation?
Yeah, well...
So it's not, you're not expanding the basement?
Am I wrong? Maybe clarify.
I was hoping to do a basement. New England, keep it warm. I thought that was bad.
I don't know whether it's better or not. I just want to know if there's a basement.
Yeah.
A lot of times an addition like this will be...
just on
will
piers.
Not have a basement, so you'll have lattice or something. And the reason I ask is because of the slope, there will be a fair bit of the concrete will be exposed from the rear elevation.
We could bring the clapboard down to cover that if that's an issue.
No, it's not a design detail.
I'm sorry.
I just wanted to get a full understanding of what the view would be from the rear, consistent with the
testimony. It would be similar to what's from the side.
Yeah, understood.
And, you know...
It's an expansion of the basement and the first floor.
Yeah. It by no means would look two stories.
I didn't suggest it would. I just want to get an idea. On the double lot, is it truly a double lot? You use it all as one property? You own both lots, same name, one tax bill?
I get one tax bill.
Do you know if there was ever a structure on that second lot?
I don't know.
Is the garage...
I doubt it.
Does the garage look like your house? Same kind of clapboard, same color?
Yeah.
I might have it.
Doesn't look out of place at all?
No.
Okay. It's a big lot. Yeah, okay. All right, thank you.
Let's see if there's anybody else who wishes to speak in opposition to this application for variance.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for coming to me. The record indicates there's no such person present. Mr. Baker, do you want to sum up, or do you have any comments before we decide your application?
Well, he was going through his thing beyond the retaining wall. I do own it. It's not a thin strip. It's 10 feet in some places. It's substantial. And, it's my property. I pay the taxes on it. And when I did I didn't put that concrete there after the last variance. I did it in the springtime because I had gone to broach this subject with various people before it got to this, and come to find out that the Browns were going around the back to secretly oppose it. I mean, Cunningham Park in particular, which they didn't. They finally, but they wouldn't even hear me out, and I'm thrilled that they're not here in opposition. Okay, maybe I was able to present my side, which they had never heard before. But it wasn't easy to do. So I kind of took issue with that. And there's a nail there. And I put that marker, in on my property in both directions, at least 3 inches probably. But the stake on the other corner, disappeared not long after it went in. And so that's kind of a problem. I don't want the nail to disappear as well. You pay a lot of money for these things. And it's to know where the boundary is. I don't have the money to do what I would like to do, today, which is when that wall goes, it would be, a nice retaining wall. But, they're not cheap, and so it gets put on hold. Maybe that addresses that the lawyer brought up. And it's clearly not a two-story. I don't know how you could see it as a two-story.
I think he's just saying because of the slope, it makes it appear to be a two-story.
Throwing snow on the street, that's ludicrous. As far as, it's a very difficult road. You know, the town spending, has equipment there all the time getting stuck. I don't try and hinder that. I know the guys that come by to do it. I've pulled them out myself with my own truck. You know, so that's just nonsense. I don't know about light and visual. I don't know how 4 feet, it doesn't seem like that much to me. That's pretty much all I have
okay,
to say.
Okay, great. Well, thank you for summing up, and thank you for coming tonight as Mr. Genduso. As we did at the last hearing, we're obliged to discuss your application in open session and to vote on it. So we intend to do that here and now. So, Mr. Daber, do you want to be heard?
Sure do. This is a tough one for me. It's a relatively, modest in terms of, the width of the extension, the 4 feet. On the other hand, it does increase a previously existing. I guess it's a six-foot nonconformity, right? And make it a 10-foot nonconformity. So it's the setback there would only be half the distance that it's supposed to be. And I have trouble with the statutory factors. And I frankly would like to hear what my colleagues here have to say about it in discussion.
Mr. Mullins, you want to be heard? Thanks, Ted.
So in a lot of many cases over many years, we've granted variances from the setback provisions where the proposed structure would be attractive, would be otherwise consistent with nearby dwellings in the neighborhood and had neighborhood support. And that's been the position taken by this board for many years. But in this application has some neighborhood support, but it doesn't have all neighborhood support. And in the absence of meeting the statutory standard, or even coming, in my opinion, close to the statutory standard, I really can't support the variance. Despite the fact that I agree with Ted that it's modest, and it may be attractive, but that's not our job. Our job is to enforce the law. And I don't think the 48 Section 10 requirements are met, given the fact that there's really nothing peculiar about here. It appears that there's other ways to enlarge the property. I don't think a hardship's been established. So I can't support the variance. That's where I am.
Okay. My view is very similar to Mr. Mullen, in that many times in Milton's a tight neighborhood, a lot of small lots, and so many times we're lenient in enforcing the statutory requirements if there is assent by all of the neighbors, but and particularly if the opposition is due to invidious reasons, not in good faith. I can't make that finding here. I think there's no conformity with the statutory requirements for a variance. And I think, while I understand why it would be helpful to you, I think we may actually be doing you a disservice if we granted a variance, because you would find yourself in the Superior Court or the Land Court. There's a 21-day appeal period, on the 20-day appeal period. On the 21st day, you'd be in the Superior Court with the neighbors suing you. You'd spend a fortune, in my view, and I think you'd have absolutely no chance whatsoever to hold a variance. So you're going to cost yourself a lot of money in legal fees. You're going to cost the town money in legal fees. You're going to cost the neighbors money in legal fees. Because as a matter of law, the Supreme Judicial Court, if you read the cases where they review variances, the court is extremely strict in requiring strict conformity with the variance statute. in order to uphold a variance, and they're very quick to reverse variances that are on fuzzy grounds or whatever. So I honestly think, just like in the last hearing, that you, even if we wanted to give you the variance, and I guess we'd love to be able to help you out, legally we can't do it. We're sworn to uphold the law. So I don't think you've met your burden or come close to meeting your burden, even though you've presented a very good in good faith application to try to get the variance. And you certainly ran around to get a lot of signatures from neighbors, which is very helpful. Regretfully, some of the neighbors who did object in email form, particularly one who's not able to be present tonight, is an attorney. And the Browns hired their own attorney to appear, who basically set forth the standards. So I don't think you meet the requirements for a variance, and I don't think I could vote for your variance as a matter of law, even if I have sympathy for you. But that having been said, something that Mr. Shinman said I thought was important, and I think he said it in good faith, is he indicated that there are ways to deal with issues like this. Mr. Genduso, who's been here before, he's a terrific architect. He may be able to meet with the neighbors and may be able to make several suggestions as to different alternatives that may not be perfect for you, but can get you the additional room that that would benefit your family. There are mediators out there who do this type of work. I think, from what I heard, that there are ways to get this done. I don't know, because I'm not a builder, I'm not an architect, but I think that some good faith and thoughtful communication with the neighbors, particularly the neighbors who are objecting here, would go a long way towards getting a solution to your housing issue. I know it's easy to say, well, we deny the variance, but if you don't like the neighborhood, you don't like your neighbors, you should move. But that's not realistic, and it's not fair, because you've got a beautiful house, and to try to replicate that house somewhere else in Milton or buy a house similar to that with this economy, with housing prices going to the sky, it's not easy for families, and like yourself, to do that. You're not a multimillionaire. I wish you were. I hope we all were. But so I think there are practical solutions here. If there's good faith negotiations with the neighbors, and particularly Mr. Shinman, many times owners get personally involved, and they get personally involved, and it just kind of makes the situation worse. So many times, if you are conducting negotiations through people who have the skills of Mr. Genduso or some mediators, or if you have legal counsel who can work with Mr. Shinman, there may be a result out there for you that's doable. But as I say, it may not be perfect, but it may be doable, and you're trying to get more space for your family, and that's admirable. So I think the consensus of the board is that we're not going to grant this variance. We can certainly hear from Mr. Daber if he's reconsidered. The issue is a technical issue, since you're not represented by counsel here. In my view, and Mr. Mullen will be the first to correct me, that if we vote this variance down, then you can't reapply for a variance. I believe it's 3 years. Is that right, Jeffrey? That's my memory. You couldn't reapply for 3 years. And that may be a substantial imposition on you and your family, particularly if there is a solution that can be worked out between the parties. So you have the opportunity here, as you did last time when you ran into similar opposition, to ask the board to withdraw, to allow you to withdraw your application without prejudice, which means you can come back and refile it.
I'd like to do that.
And I think that's really in your best interest here. And I think if you get counsel or have Mr. Genduso talk to Mr. Shinman or work a dynamic where people are working towards the common goal. I think you may be able to get come before us. You've got a lot of assents to the variance. Come before us with an assent to two variants, and then we can apply a different standard because there's no likelihood of an appeal. And court proceedings against the town of Milton, which are expensive. So so we have a motion by Mr. Baker to withdraw his application without prejudice. Does any board member want to be heard on this? Any member of the public want to be heard? Okay. Nobody wants to be heard. So all those in favor of allowing Mr. Baker's application to withdraw this application with prejudice, without prejudice, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, Mr. Baker, there we are. So good luck to you. I hope you work with the neighbors. I think, sure, you want your photographs back? Or, well, take this, certainly take this back. And these, you have one photograph, I think, here.
Is that yours or?
No. Oh, that's yours as well. Mr. Shinman, maybe you can be of some help to everyone here by maybe suggesting some alternatives or keeping the process moving towards some constructive result. I'd appreciate that very much. And thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Okay, so we're finished our first hearing. Give us about 2 or 3 minutes and we'll be on to our second hearing.
Yeah.
Okay. Wait. Nothing to do. I'm really sorry for the guy. He doesn't
Yeah.
Rough
justice.
I kind of felt the same way, but I did kind of feel like it. 4 feet really isn't that, you know. But and also, you know, on the other side of that driveway is the park.
Are we on? Are we live?
No. No. It may be live.
Yeah.
It's,
well,
yeah, I know it's the park, yeah. Cunningham, yeah.
So,
yeah. Well, you know, one other thing is, I'm okay with it.
Well,
I definitely would.
He can do whatever he wants. Okay, what's this one? Oh my God.
You been reading that, Ted?
My wife. Said surgery.
How you doing?
Good.
The wife had surgery with the orthopedic surgeon. She's fine.
No cookies?
Hi, Frank, how are you?
I'm doing very well.
Yourself. You're going to be presenting the
yes,
the case?
I will.
Oh, great. Oh, Mr. Brondack, how are you, sir? Mr. DeLuna, it's been about a century since we've seen you last.
Okay.
Not quite that long.
No, not quite.
Okay.
Lost my job.
Yes.
Everyone ready to go? Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to call to order our second hearing of the evening. This is the 7:45 hearing. It's about 8:20 in the evening. And this is the application of Thayer Nursery at 270 Hillside Street in Milton. Appealing a decision of the building commissioner dated September 22nd, 2015, in which the building inspector, who's with us tonight, Mr. Joseph Prondak, determined that the applicant could only sell products at retail on the site, which are directly and incidental to the permitted nursery uses at 270 Hillside Street, and that in particular articles of art, clothing, ceramics, jewelry, housewares, candles, soap, and carvings are not allowed to be sold at retail at their nursery during holiday fairs or similar events during Thanksgiving and Christmas time seasons. It's my understanding, but Mr. DeLuna can help us with this, that I believe the applicant is seeking basically a special permit in order to conduct a holiday festival on a specific day. December 6th seems to stick in my mind, but I may be wrong, between certain hours like 10 to 4 in the afternoon, as they have done apparently in the past. So my name is John Leonard. I'm chairman of the Board of Appeals. With me this evening, to my immediate left, is Board Member Ted Daber, and to my immediate right is Board Member Jeffrey Mullen. The rules are going to be the same as at the first hearing. We'll hear from the applicant or the applicant's counsel. Then we'll hear from persons who have questions of the applicant or applicant's counsel, and then hear from persons who wish to speak in support of this appeal from Mr. Prondak's letter, which I suspect is seeking some type of an amendment to the existing special permit, whether it's on a single basis or on an annual basis. And looking at Ms. Oldfield's letter to the town, the event is the 12th annual Holiday Boutique, which is scheduled on Sunday, December 5, not the 6th, December 5, from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. in the evening. As I mentioned, we're tape recording the proceedings as usual, even though the matter is being televised, apparently in several dimensions. The accurate and official record of the transaction is of this hearing is the tape. So we have summarized the advertisement. We have the application and the appeal from Mr. Prondak's ruling. We have Ms. Oldfield's email to the town administrator, Anne Marie Fagan. And we have just received some materials from Mr. Francis DeLuna, who represents the nursery, which Mr. DeLuna, I'm sure, will be going into some detail regarding those matters, so I won't do that for the present time. We did receive a submittal from Attorney Matthew Dunn. I don't know whether you've had a chance to see that, Mr. DeLuna. I believe it was delivered at something like 4:35 or 5 o'clock this evening via email. Since I have to do some more ceremonial things here. Yeah, thank you. Mr. Mullen's going to give you a copy of that letter so you can read it while we continue on with some of the procedure.
A couple of exhibits, but you have
issues.
The decision and the court decision.
So we did receive two pieces of correspondence from members of the Board of Selectmen, but speaking on their individual capacities and not for the full Board of Selectmen. Normally I summarize these things as I did in the hearing for Mr. Baker, but if I start, I think I will read both selectmen's letter just out of respect for the Board of Selectmen. We did receive certain emails from interested citizens On 10/25/2015, we received 3 emails in favor of their nursery's appeal. On the 27th of October, we received 5 emails in favor of the their nursery's position. And on the 28th of October, we received 5 emails in favor of the applicant's position and 1 email in opposition's position. So let me deal with the selectmen's letters. The first letter is from Selectman Kathleen M. Conlon, a member of the Board of Selectmen, but as I said, writing in her individual capacity, otherwise known as Katie Conlon. She writes, Dear members of the Board of Appeals, as you know, Thayer Nursery has appealed from a decision of the Building Commissioner, Joseph Prondek, dated September 22, 2015, to the effect that Thayer may not offer arts and crafts items like jewelry, ceramics, small housewares, artwork, baked goods, and the like for sale as a, quote, holiday boutique, close quote, open house to be held on Sunday, December 6, 2015. This matter will be heard by the Board of Appeals on Wednesday, October 28, 2015. I'm not able to personally attend the meeting to testify when you take comments from members of the public. Therefore, I'm submitting this letter in support of Thayer's appeal. Mr. Prondak's decision is based upon the permit to operate a nursery business that the Board of Appeals has issued to Thayer. Generally speaking, I have supported Mr. Prondak's conservative approach to interpreting Thayer's permit when determining which businesses are allowed and which uses are not allowed. However, I urge the Board of Appeals to take into account the unique nature of the one-day holiday boutique that, in my view, would support a limited exception to the permitted nursery use of Thayer's property at Hillside Street. I have heard from a number of Milton residents who support Thayer's holiday boutique and hope that it will continue from year to year. As one of the local representatives, I wish to pass along their positive comments to the Board of Appeals. Thayer has held the holiday boutique for the past 11 years, and the event has become a winter tradition that many residents of the town enjoy and look forward to attending each year. Thayer's holiday boutique builds a sense of community. It contributes to the quality of life enjoyed by Milton residents and provides young families with an inexpensive way to usher in the holiday season. I understand that the sale of homemade arts and crafts items have been an integral part of the holiday boutique over the years. The Oldfield family has put on the event to good use for charitable purposes, raising money that they have donated to the Milton Food Pantry, the Milton High School Music Department, and the American Legion Post number 114. Thayer's Holiday Boutique should be celebrated for the great Milton tradition that it has become to be. There may be some adverse impact on Thayer's abutters due to increased traffic and parking in the area, but it is unlikely that the sale of arts and crafts items at the Holiday Boutique will unduly burden abutters. Surely any small adverse impact on the abutters on only one day of the year will be outweighed by both the benefit that the Holiday Boutique will bring to many Milton residents and the joyful holiday memories it will instill in children. I urge the Board of Appeals to grant limited relief to Thayer by amending its nursery permit as necessary to allow Thayer to sell arts, crafts, and other small retail items in connection with the holiday open house to be held on the first Sunday of December each year. Thank you for your consideration, and best regards, sincerely, Kathleen M. Conlon. So we thank Katie Conlon for her submission. We also received a letter, which was attached to an email from Selectman David Burns. It was delivered via email on October 27th, 2015. And Mr. Burns writes, Dear members of the Board of Appeals, I am writing on behalf of the appeal of Thayer Nursery, who requested and was denied a one-day permit for the purpose of offering the local community its 12th annual holiday boutique. This day is an annual occasion where Thayer Nursery hosts approximately 25 artisans who make their unique products available as well as to spend time and to cultivate community interest in local crafts of various kinds. We have few opportunities to share artisan crafts with our children, and this day provides a wonderful opportunity to do so. It also provides residents with an opportunity to support Made in America items, as well as to support the efforts of local artisans in promoting their crafts. It has been extremely well attended by residents, and it continues to be a day which residents look forward to as a seasonal tradition. While it is attended by people and families from all areas of the town, it is also enjoyed by the neighborhood homeowners. Many neighbors look forward to this upbeat event that for one day becomes a gathering place for our townspeople to share the holiday spirit and reconnect with neighbors and friends for something that is truly joyous. This is a family-oriented event that has been well attended and reasonably timed. It is an unofficial kickoff for the holidays for homeowners, families, and it's truly a festival day for all in attendance. I offer my support for the appeal of Thayer Nursery for this one-day permit, and I am hopeful that the board will permit this occasion to take place again this year. So we thank David Burns for his letter and his thoughts. So I think without further ado, Mr. Francis DeLuna is here on behalf of the appellant. So well, welcome back to the Board of Appeals, Mr. DeLuna. It's good to have you here.
Thank you very much.
Why don't you just introduce yourself so that...
I'm sorry. I'm Frank DeLuna from Mirtha Kalina, LLP. My office is in Woburn, Mass. And the old fields are with me, owners and operators of Thayer Nursery. To start... This is an option, I believe. Our initial request was to rescind or overturn the decision of the building inspector if this board feels that an amendment to the special permit is a more appropriate cure. We will make a bifurcated request for that. The situation is for the past 11 years and I've included in my package to you some advertisements. A holiday bazaar has been held at the Thayer Nursery. Thayer invites anywhere between 20 and 30 local artisans onto their property. All the artisans are inside the property. On the outside of the building, I'm sorry, all the artisans are inside the buildings on the property. All right, we do have the high school choir, is it? Does sing. It is not a amplified situation. They don't have music over the loudspeakers. They do have a police detail. These artisans do pay $25 a piece. That fee helps reduce the financial impact on the nursery. It is they are required to have a table, and that $25 is in part rents the table. They are required to have a chair. That $25 goes to the rental of the chairs as well as the tablecloth. All right, this is a safety issue. You don't want vendors coming in with rickety-rackety tables and chairs and all of a sudden find that we have a tort on our hands. So by requiring everything to be rented, there is a guarantee that the equipment will be sound and, in fact, looking good. The $25 also goes to a police detail, which is there for the full time. Now,
could you describe the police detail in a little more specificity?
I would have to ask one of the...
Is it a Milton police detail? And
we call the Milton Police Department. and if they're available to fill the detail, they do it, and if they can't, then it gets too...
You're Mr. Josh Oldfield, just for the record.
Yes, Mr. Josh Oldfield, 24 Forest Street, lifelong resident of the town, owner of the nursery. Back to the police detail.
The police detail. How many officers are there, and what do they do, and how long are they there?
Based on my discussion with the police department over the years, they feel comfortable with having one on the corner. They pick a spot, and they actually work in conjunction with our staff. They like to do that. They feel we have a good grasp of managing traffic with our experience over the past 12 years. We use a two-way radio system. Our employees count cars. We allocate approximately 6 employees to mitigate and move the traffic along as spaces become available. We take priority to handicapped people and valet park their vehicles. So we have a mechanism in place to handle the parking. With regard to the vendor parking, we allocate a space. They come in a couple of hours earlier so they can set up without any conflict in of running into the public as well as vendor setup. So there is a program there to handle all of that. And the vendors are not allowed to leave during the course of the event based on our parking techniques. We block them in, so they don't have that ability to do that. And we pull the vehicles around to the greenhouse and load the vendors' wares into their vehicles, so it's an expeditious process.